Like everything these days, what we're doing here is in part an experiment. So thank you in advance for your patience if and when things don't go exactly according to plan. One thing I should double check here, Gabby, are we recording? Since we told some other folks we'd post a recording later?
Yes, I just started recording as soon as you said we're going to go ahead and start.
Oh, okay, good. Well, I'm glad we can capture that meta moment in there. I'm just going to speak very briefly here because then I want to hand things over to the recovery team who's been so generous in sharing their expertise with us today. My name is Eric Hoyt. I'm an associate professor at University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I am the director of Media History Digital Library. We are an open access initiative where we've now scanned a little over 2.5 million pages of books and magazines, trade papers related to film, broadcasting, and recorded sound. And we were extremely fortunate to receive a grant last year from the ACLS. I'm the PI on the grant, and I've been working on it closely with my co-PI, Kelly Conway, at University of Wisconsin-Madison. And this is called a digital extension grant. And the ACLS had, well, what I think is a great idea, which was to say, there's a lot of digital projects that are out there that are doing good work, but they could be doing more. And I think we certainly fell into that category. We've done a good job in terms of scanning material and putting it out on the web and letting people search it. But we had some very big blind spots. It was a collection that, for copyright reasons, really had to tend to the past. You know, we're scanning public domain work. But another major blind spot was the global scope of the collection, or the lack thereof. It was a very US English language centric collection. And so in this particular grant, what we wanted to do was really to globalize it, to include works published outside of the United States, and also to remember that there are lots of things published in the United States that aren't published in English, and to capture that as part of our project too. There's other goals in this project that are related to improving the database, search, user experience, and those are things that we're working on, and they're things that in some cases have gotten more complicated because of the pandemic and not being able to travel and not being able to access some of the things that we thought we'd be able to. But I also have to say, this experience for me has also been a reminder of just how important and valuable that work of digitizing material, putting it out on the web in a way that's free and accessible so that people can use it when they can't go to a library or archive anymore. And you know, as we're all living through a time that I think I speak for us all that we never thought we would have to. But it's also, in other words, been a reminder, as hard as certain parts of this project have become, that it's really valuable. One aspect of this ACLS grant that I also really appreciated was that the ACLS really wanted to promote collaborations. So in addition to saying we're looking for good projects in the space of digital humanities that could become better, they were also saying we want those projects to learn from other projects that have been working in this space. And you know, for that reason and many others, I'm just delighted that as part of this project, we've been able to work with Recovering the U.S. Hispanic Literary Heritage, a project that has been going much longer than Media History Digital Library. Some of you may know it well, others of you might not. And so what I'd like to do is to hand things over to the recovery team to please introduce all of us a little more fully to the project, to yourselves, and then we can get into some of this nitty-gritty work in terms of thinking about how we can use the open access collection of Media History Digital Library, but also these open source tools, Omeka and Timeline.js, to really be able to deliver rich, engaging experiences for our students. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Eric. Thanks everyone for the opportunity to speak with you all today. Eric generously reached out to the recovery about a year and a half ago about, you know, doing this collaboration. We were very excited. It's amazing to be able to work across the nation and across our fields in this way. And one of the things that we have always strived to do through recovery is really to establish, to demonstrate the reach, right, and the presence of communities that speak languages other than English in the United States. And so this is really like bringing that to fruition. So before I start, there's a few logistic issues that I'd like to point out. In case you are not aware, we've mentioned several times we're recording this session, so that please feel free to, if you do not want to be on the camera at any moment, you can, you know, turn off your video. What else? Other logistics. We will be hopefully we'll have time for a Q&A at the end of the sessions, but please feel free to ask questions on the chat. We have somebody answering those questions for you, and I will say her name in a minute as soon as I introduce you, introduce you to her. And lastly, just so you know, the way we imagine this session is, this session is informative, and it will cover a lot of things that could be very basic. And so we're imagining an audience who has little to no knowledge of technology or digital humanities to people who have a lot of knowledge. And so please bear with us in that sense. And in that regard, feel free to ask any question that does, about anything that doesn't, for which you don't understand. Okay, feel free to ask any of those questions on the chat and or whenever we have the opportunity to invite you to ask those questions vocally. And lastly, we will make, we've shared the link to the Bitly that has access to a folder where we have resources, we have links to the assignments, we have the PowerPoint presentation, and some other resources as well. And so on that link, we will upload this presentation, this recording, as soon as we are done with it, so that you can have access to it at a later time. And we will also share a copy of a transcript of the chat in that message. So if there are questions that you maybe don't see as we're answering them. Let me see. I think that's all. Hopefully I won't remember something in the middle of my presentation. So my name's Gabriela Gorgavi Baez-Aventura from the University of Houston. I'm an associate professor of Spanish. I'm also the executive editor at Arte Público Press and the co-founder of the U.S. Latino Digital Humanities Center with my colleague, Carolina Villarroel, who will be presenting on recovery today as well. Carolina is the Brown Foundation Director of Research at the Recovery Project. Lorena Gothero will be presenting with us today. She is our digital programs manager. She will be handling the workshop on Omeka and the specific training on Omeka in Timeline. And our newly minted U.S. Latino DH postdoctoral fellow, who is doing her public service today with us, Linda Garcia Merchant. She's our postdoc, and she'll be with us for 2 years. And so we're very happy to bring her into this family today, and to show her off to the world in this way. Let me see if there's anything else that I need to ask. I think that's it. So there's a Bitly, and we posted it up on the, it's here on this image, and then we'll continue to put it on the chat. And I think We're off with Caro. Let me. So we'll start with an introduction of the recovery project, and then we'll talk the agenda. Go back there. There we go. So the agenda for today, just so that you have an idea, is so we'll be talking first a little bit about the Recovering the U.S. Hispanic Literary Heritage Program. I'll talk a little bit briefly about how the USLDH Center was, the program was begun. Linda will talk about the project assessment management. Then we'll give you a 5-minute break to log into Omeka or Timeline, or you know, do whatever you want at that moment. And then we'll go into the workshops, and then Lorena will walk us through what it is to be working with Omeka and Timeline and do some of the exercises. And then hopefully at the end, we'll have a Q&A, time for Q&A. All right, Caro. You're muted.
Sorry. Can you go back?
Mm-hmm.
For some reason, it's not letting me go back.
There.
Okay, sorry for that hiccup. Thank you, Gabby. And thank you everybody for being here. It's great to be able to share these virtual spaces. You know, we never thought about this be possible like 15 years ago or 20 or 10 years ago. So it's moving. Okay, am I moving it or?
I did.
Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about the recovery project. We are, it keeps moving. So like Eri said before, we've been around for almost 30 years doing this kind of research. The project is called Recovering the U.S. Hispanic Literary Heritage Program. And it's an international program to recover, locate, preserve, and make available the written legacy of Latinas and Latinos in the U.S. since colonial times until 1980. So it's a very extensive program. With colleagues all over the country and around the world doing this kind of job, creating what it's an alternative archive to the traditional archive that was not preserving this kind of materials for different reasons. So the scholars were discovering all these materials produced in the United States in attics and libraries, but not in archives, etc., etc., in the hands of family members that preserve some of these boxes. So, and realized that these needed to be studied, needed to be recovered. So they started working this alternative archive, and 30 years later, we have accumulated thousands of original books, manuscripts, archival materials, ephemera, photographs, an extensive authority list, a number of newspapers in microfilm and digital format, as well as personal papers. We are located at the University of Houston, and right there you go. And one of the things that we did at the beginning of the project was to create a bibliography, to go through the country, city by city, state by state, trying to locate what was out there, you know, and we're still doing it, that job. It's something that is a work in progress. We keep finding materials, we keep locating small historical societies and small museums that might have this kind of material. So we created a bibliography and we search for everything that had a Latino surname, but not necessarily, because Latinas and Latinos can come with different last names, and everything that was in Spanish, but not necessarily, because Latinas and Latinos were writing in different languages. So we created this bibliography that right now has more than 20,000 records that includes poetry, pamphlets, historical documents, cookbooks, religious materials, et cetera, et cetera. Everything that you can think of that was produced by Latinas and Latinos in the written format. See, I'm having a little bit of trouble moving around. So one of the components of the program was to recover newspapers. Newspapers were a very important part of the Latino culture, and it was a way to distribute information and to connect with the community, because to be able to print a book was very difficult and very expensive during that time. So the best way to do it was through the newspapers. So you find in the newspapers information, general information, political information, and then also, can you put my, and also, novels, serialized fiction, poetry, everything that was part of the literary environment of the Latina and Latina of the Latino community. So it is believed that Latinos and Latinas published around 2,700 newspapers during the period of the 1808, where El Mississippi was published. That is the first newspaper published in the United States by Latinos, and then until 1960. We have bibliographic control of around 2,500, and we have in-house around 1,400 newspapers. And when I say newspapers that we have in-house, these are in microfilm, like I said before, and physical paper, and then and digital format. And something to keep in mind is that when we are very lucky, we're able to preserve to locate the whole run of a newspaper, but in most cases we have a few issues and sometimes just a page, and in a few cases just a piece of the newspaper, because the paper used for newspapers was very acidic. So we know that a lot of this information is already lost. So we are in a race against time to try to locate these newspapers and preserve it and digitize it as soon as possible. So as you see in this image, we have newspapers that, anarchist newspapers, we have a collection probably around more than 100 anarchist newspapers, newspapers written by women, like La Voz de la Mujer, and newspapers written in French, in Ladino, the language of the Sephardic Jews, and English, bilingual newspapers. So it's a very, very rich collection of newspapers. There you go. So one of the things that we recover as well are collections. And these come to us, you know, through people that know about what we're doing and just contact us directly. People that do not sometimes trust the archive, or they were not received at the time by an archive. Things are changing right now, and that's very encouraging. And but a lot of people in our community also request for the materials to go back to them. And we completely understand that. If we try to tell people to donate collections to archives, ultimately, because we want for these collections to be preserved in an environment that will be healthy for these documents, but also we want for these collections to take a space in the archives and to show a real presence of Latinos and Latinas in the culture and history of the United States. But we work with a post-custodial model. That means that we retrieve the collections, we work with the donors, we create digital surrogates, and then we return the collection with a digital copy to the family or the institution. We have partnerships with institutions in Cuba, in Puerto Rico, because these materials travel a lot. And we have people in the exile in the 1800s, then went back to their countries and took materials with them, or publications that they produce in the United States with them back to their countries. And that also belongs to the history of the United States. So, and the same thing, you know, on the other way around, we have materials that stayed here and they're part of the history and the culture of the of that specific country. So one of the collections that I think speak a lot of the work that we do, the kind of detective work that we do, is the Leonor Villegas de Magallanes. As you might notice right now, we locate everything, but we particularly we try to recover women voices through the history and Latina voices. Because if people thought that Latinos and Latinas were not producing or writing before 1960 in the United States, much less women, and we have found countless voices, newspapers, and newspapers called Feminismo Internacional in the 1920s, for example. And this collection in particular speaks about a Mexican-American woman, a Mexican woman working in Laredo, Texas, in the border, by the time of the Mexican Revolution. It's a transnational figure who decided to fight during the revolution on the side of one of the most famous generals in the revolution, General Carranza. So she created a group of nurses to fight in the revolution, inviting Anglo women, Mexican women, and Mexican American women. By the end of the revolution, she decides to write her memoirs. She wrote it in Spanish. Nobody wanted to publish it in Spanish in Mexico. She rewrote it in English. Nobody wanted to publish it in the United States because it's an account, a historical account by a woman. And then, what happens is that a reference of the newspaper of the memoir was found in a piece of newspaper, and the newspaper was in the Netherlands. So one of our associates had to travel to the Netherlands to retrieve the whole newspaper and to get to the archive that was amazingly sitting here with a family member in Houston, Texas. So we were able to retrieve this collection and reconstruct the history of not only Leonor Villegas de Magnon, but about this the women that were fighting during the revolution with another take, not just the Adelitas in general, but specific women with names and last names. So this is kind of the work that we do. And to show you how we work from the archive to a digital visualization, we had an associate, a professor from the Houston Community College who did research work with us, and she created a beautiful Omega exhibit based on this collection called Entre Balas y Rugidos. And to be true to the collection, we decided to have this exhibit in English and in Spanish bilingually so we can share it in Mexico. If you're wondering where to get our collections, we have databases where we share some of the information that we have with Newsbank and EBSCOhost. I encourage you to go to your library, ask your librarians, and see if you can access these databases. It's been very helpful for our researchers to be able to access this information through the databases. Linda is telling me that I'm running out of time. So just to finish, I want to leave you with information about public domain. If this is something that you need to consider, and you're gonna see later and during the presentation, you need to consider copyright when you start working on projects. We have seen several projects where they are sometimes completed and they cannot see the light of day because they have copyright issues. So I gather some information for you that will be available later about the years, you know, the span of years that you can, you know, and the laws that you can consider for your project, and then a list of copyright resources. And with that, I leave it to Gaby.
Great, thank you, Caro. So here, let me go back. Sorry, going crazy with the PowerPoint today. So. Before we go into the workshop, I wanted to just give you a really quick definition of what digital humanities means to us, and we base this on Amanda Visconti's fabulous essay, "A Digital Humanities: What, Why, and How," which is published through Haystack, and this is readily available online. We also put it in the resources, and. Basically, to us, we understand digital humanities as a way in which the digital is applied to humanities thinking or humanities and digital tools. But We also need to start thinking about those specific questions that guide these projects that are out there. What is the context that surrounds them? What are the communities that work with these digital humanities spaces? So for example, in our case, the work that we did with Leonor Villegas and Magnon, it is a site where you're looking at the archive of a woman who participated in the Mexican Revolution. But within that archive, you're going to find all the silences of and the intricacies of why this story was maybe not made visible before. What are some of the issues behind telling a story from a perspective that it comes from a very well-to-do woman versus a traditional soldadera story that we have. And so in this article that Amanda Visconti gives us, she talks about how there are approximately 800 different definitions for what digital humanities is. And I find that this one, right, is what really works for us. And so given that, when we created this program or this space for Latino Digital Humanities, we applied for a grant. We were, fortunately, we were able to get this grant from the Andrew Mellon Foundation to create a space that would provide development, support, and training on digital humanities projects that were based and founded on the vast materials that we have at the Recovery Program. And this is extremely important for us because it allows us to extend the work. The recovery program has been in existence for approximately 28 years. Arte Público has been like the venue for U.S. Latino contemporary literature for over 41 years. And so we know that, like, you know, we wanted to make sure that these materials do not just live in a two-dimensional way, you know, as a physical publication. We wanted to also invade the virtual world with all of these materials and really extend the scholarship, but most importantly, extend the archive itself, the voices that have been kept inside these archives and sometimes these voices did not even make it into an archive. And so that's one of the major reasons into making sure that this space exists so that people get training, get the support to create these projects, you know, using recovered material. We've also extended into creating an instance for digital publication. We're working with Manifold. We created APP Digital, and we will be releasing some books through APP Digital so that these books can be shared as open resource materials. And the magnificent thing about working with Manifold is that these are materials that can be shared in a class, they can be presented in a class, and they can be annotated in a class as well. And so it allows us to continue the pedagogical work that we've been doing through Recovery and Arte Público. Of course, just to promote and foster interdisciplinary scholarly work as we're doing right now, provide a communal virtual space where we identify other people who are doing Latina and Latino digital humanities. And that is why we created the hashtag USLDH. When we started working on building this, the foundation for this center, and we approached foundations, a lot of times we were told that there were no Latinos, there was little to no interest on U.S. Latino digital humanities work. And if there was, some of that work was already being done. And when they mentioned some of the projects, a lot of those projects were primarily Latin American based or Spanish based. And so we scoured the internet and did a little bit of research, and we crowdsourced a list, and it's on the list of our resources that documents the over 40 projects, 40 instances of digital humanities work across the US, and when we went back and showed it to them, they couldn't say no, that there was no interest. And the last thing is to establish a Latino DH hub. And to us, this is really important because it will be, hopefully it will be like the space where we can show, we can at least keep an instance or a copy of any of the digital humanities projects that are taking place, that are occurring throughout the US. In this slide, I'd like to really like give you a little bit about the background into or an idea of how do we approach digital humanities and a lot of the work that we do. So key questions that we ask is, and this is based on a training on social justice, thinking about social justice scholarship, thinking about decolonial instances and opportunities to begin to question the archive, right? Question discourses where voices, minority voices, anything that is not written in English has been left out. And so we always ask ourselves, so how do we approach this U.S. Latinx experience, right? What is the perspective on this? Who's telling the story, right? How do we understand the importance of these ethnic materials within the U.S.? Do we incorporate other languages? And if we do, if you look at at many of the projects that we have done, one of our goals is to do our work bilingually. And this also has to do with issues of accessibility. We're very committed to working with our community. We want to make sure that our comunidad feels represented in the work that we're doing. And also working with the different registers of the language. And so if community feels okay with using Spanglish, well then that's what we will use, and we will respect that and honor that as a language that is validated through the creation of by incorporating it into the project itself. We also think about how to create meaningful and respectful data. Carolina mentioned the previous one about copyright issues, et cetera, but we think about making sure that the data really is organized and corresponds to the materials in the way in which the community has shared it with us. We also, a lot of times, if community is involved, if these projects are going back to a specific community and the community has the opportunity to participate physically with them, we take their comments fully into consideration. When the community is not there, we are very careful about doing a lot of research to contextualize as much as possible, working with experts across the country, across the nation, across the world. We have the recovery has a board of approximately how many people, Carol? Like 50, 60 people across experts across the United States in various fields in the humanities. And so we rely on that knowledge to make sure that we create materials that are respectable. And then lastly, how do we engage the local communities? Like I said, we try to do a lot of events within the community so that the community sees our presence there. The community also contacts us because if you look, if the Recovery and Arte Público Press have been doing a lot of work, have created a space within historical and literary discourse within the universities as well. Higher ed institutions. And so the community does seek us out quite a bit, but we work I'm not sure if many of you have had the opportunity to read the amazing article by Maria Cotera on Chicana Praxis. We work from a perspective that where our community takes a primary role within the work that we're doing. And so we make sure that they're present there, that they that their voice is amplified through our work. An example of that is And that is why we find that it's important to use software that is free, that has that is easy to use, such as Omega and Timeline. This example that I have here is a timeline that was produced for LULAC Council 61 here in Houston. Is one of the oldest councils in the United States. And for them, it was extremely valuable to figure out a way to document the important events that inform their presence and their contributions to Houston and to the nation as well. And that paired up fully with the work that we're doing, because we're also in the business of documenting the presence of Latinos, right? And how Latinos have always been here, have always contributed, have always been active participants defending their rights we've been pushed to defend our status. And so this is just a really simple example of a timeline that as you can see here on the bottom, it's set up in dates. But this same exercise is also reproduced in our classrooms, where our students will take maybe a topic, right? Maybe like in my Mexican American Studies class, and I teach in the Spanish department. Students will talk about they'll walk us through the Chicano Civil Rights Movement, and then they'll either talk about the origins, or maybe they'll talk about the various events that led to the movement. Do I have any questions, Linda, or am I running out of time? Oops, sorry. What did I do? Okay, I think I went into timeline there. Let me see. Sorry.
No, you don't have, I'm sorry, I was like clicking on too many things as well. You don't have any questions.
Okay, all right.
Caro shared, shared the article from American Quarterly that, that Maria wrote.
Okay, good, thank you. So, this is another example of an Omeka exhibit that we did. And I'll talk very briefly about this example with Omeka. This is a collection that was brought to Arte Público Press by the husband of Angela de Hoyos, who was an amazing Chicana poet, activist, very important leader in the community. Her husband wanted Arte Público Press because of the recovery, because of the work that we've doing to care for these collections. He wanted us to have a copy of it, and to also see if we could produce a book of her collected poems. But most importantly, he wanted people to get to know Angela and the various different kind of work that she did. As you can see in this image that we have here, she was an artist. She produced a magazine. She was an activist. She was a poet. She was a self-taught poet and a self-taught artist. And so the online exhibit allowed us to go into a little bit of more depth and to provide a more vibrant image of her work. And so with her collection, we have been able to create two different exhibits that talk about her life. I think there's one that talks specifically about her work as a poet, as an activist. And then there's another exhibit that has been created from her collection by one of our students about her art. And so you see that that these two platforms that we have been using for recovery have been very fruitful in the way that they've been able to allow us to extend and voice and give access to these people who live in our archives, who otherwise wouldn't have had the opportunity to have that presence. And I think I'll leave it there. I think I'll pass it on to Linda, who will now talk about digital ways of building. And Linda, I'll take over the chat for now.
Okay, thank you.
Let me give you.
Can I move stuff here? Oh no.
Here we go. Yes.
Okay. Click to start. Let's see. Okay, good. Okay, great. Thank you very much, Caro and Gabi, and for this, you know, my debut opportunity to be a part of this incredible team. I'm pretty sure that I was asked to do this because, excuse me, I've been on both sides of this issue. I've made my own research site that actually informed one of the chapters of my dissertation in terms of process and motivation, along with teaching in the DH classroom students how to articulate, to translate traditional scholarship in these non-traditional ways. And so, so I want to talk a little bit today about digital ways of building and asset management. So really the beginnings of a project when students are thinking about, well, what am I going to create? How am I going to respond to this material that I'm discovering in this wonderful way that communicates, you know, things that I want to address within this site, in this hub. So when building a research site, they'll be publicly available. You want to remember your demographic, things to consider. 1/3 of your visitors are going to be very familiar with either your topics or elements of your topic. 1/3 will be somewhat familiar, and the last third will know little or nothing about your topic. So the goal is to reach the 2/3 that know nothing or a bit about your topic. So as you consider your topic, keep in mind how your final project will answer your research question. Unlike a traditional paper, a digital project has elements that speak to your research question and communicate ways to consider both the question and the topic using visual and audio elements along with content. Consider that the interactive project will present more questions and offer more considerations of your topic and your research question to the visitor who is unfamiliar with you and your story. So if you are faculty working with students to produce these kind of interactive projects, how do you teach a software or application so that students can articulate a thesis and claims of proof using these interactive applications? The key here is scaffolding. The software application should be scaffolded in the same ways as the content of the course. So in other words, each week's unit should introduce some element of the software with exercises bridging the technology with the content being produced. For example, in this workshop, we're going to look at Omeka and Timeline.js. Each of those applications has a series of elements and actions required to use them, these applications. Organizing assets by type, defining types of content, creating asset lists, converting them to CVS. Consider breaking each element or action into two parts. Learning to use the element, then applying that element to some aspect of the project. So for example, we're gonna look at, oh, I did that already, sorry. I'm reading too many pages here, hold on. So, okay, so when you think about a project, the first question we wanna ask ourselves is what are we gonna build and why? To do this, we have to analyze the topic at hand. Creating a concept or conceptualization helps a reader, researcher, understand what elements make up a topic. For example, when we think about Mexican cinema, and this is the example I'm going to use through this part of the talk, we consider any number of topics, including directors, actors, cinematography, the industry in general, the history of distribution, or perhaps Mexico's relationship to American Hollywood. So what we have here that we're looking at is an example of building the research concept without employing more complex tools like spreadsheets or flowcharts. Here we see how the researcher has looked at all the assets that this researcher, meaning me, accumulated for my site. The color coding begins to sort assets by type and subject. The colors represent the type of document. Yellow are articles from publications, blue are the publications in general, purple is organizations and subjects, and pink are events. This process can take a while, but once you've moved assets around in a way that makes sense, the question you are asking the site to communicate will also begin to make sense. The one thing I want to really drive home here is that as you are doing all of this organizing and sorting of this idea that you have, document your research journey. This is going to be important when you have to talk about the process of creating whatever the interactive project is that you're creating. As you are journaling this process, you can draw on that to then document what was important to focus on, what was important to the direction of the site that you wanted the site to take. So document the research journey from the onset. Okay. So then the question becomes, now you've moved, how do we move from the analog to the digital? So in other words, how do we go from push pins and a corkboard and little, you know, color pieces of paper that help to decide how to organize this, moving it over to spreadsheets? If you don't learn anything else today, spreadsheets are your friend and you will do a lot of them. So here you have an example of how this concept, this analog concept, is moving into this digital format. Here we're looking at how each of the green columns that we saw in the, with the push pins on the corkboard on the analog system becomes a type of identifier. So, and this highlighted orange section, you see a column that is defined by organizations, which is a subject. Activists, another subject. And notice that I don't use persons or people or subjects. I use very specifically activists because I'm going to be defining certain kinds of people. So see how this is breaking down into these different kinds of organizational ways. This kind of sorting and organizing is an ongoing process. Working from analog to digital helps to sort through the clutter that can occur when all this data is accumulated. So think of this as organizing the potential elements of what you are going to finally ultimately produce. And on the subject of elements, all this data that you're going to collect from the library system, from the media digital library, from the Wisconsin Historical Society library, from Instagram, from Vimeo, all of these places are going to render a variety of file types. Okay, so like PDFs, MP4s, MP3s, and locations where those files are stored. Because remember, the applications you'll be working with will require URLs that end in a file name and a file extension. Again, something you're going to go over during the workshop. Some of these images are going to require additional handling. All of the writing you're going to do for this site will require the use of Word docs or spreadsheets. All this data in all these places needs to exist in one place where they can be managed and their processing recorded, documented, and updated. The solution to this is having a good asset management system. In this discussion, the definition of assets that I'm talking about here are images, still images, films, PDFs, sound, and any documents you're using to produce this interactive project. So, and here I want to talk a little bit about Google products, very little bit about Google products. And as you can see, here's a copy of a spreadsheet that I'm using and in my Google workplace. I know this is my Google workplace because in the upper right-hand corner, you'll see a circular icon that indicates it is MySpace. That's a photograph of me working with someone, and I know that, and that's how I know that it's MySpace. That's my Google profile picture. Moving to the left, you'll see that there are, this is also a shared space, and you'll see two more circular icons of other members of our team that are working within this space. So I've shared this document. So already we're seeing that this document can be a collaborative effort and can be thought of as a starting point with data that is transferable to the number of different applications that you're going to want to use it for. So think about this working spreadsheet as the place to store everything as you have it, as you've gotten it, what you're going to do with it, and what needs to be done with it. Not just for Omeka and Timeline.js, but for some of the other broader applications that you're going to use it for, blog sites, websites, and presentation software. So you'll see that this worksheet has two worksheets, the DOI legend sheet and the file status. Again, these are best practices that we use in the production of our own assets. So I'm going to go over the DOI legend worksheet first. So DOI, for those of you not familiar, stands for Document Object Identifier. This is a way where assets on the internet are defined. If you ever notice in publications, there's a DOI number that is applied to publications from journals. And that is the actual, that is the number that identifies that asset for publications, kind of like the ISBN identifies books. So, but we also use it in this way because it's a regularly used statement within this work. Think of your DOI legend as the roadmap for what is happening with your files. So just like a legend on a map, this is going to help to define abbreviations you're creating, descriptions of things. This is where we begin to think about things like schema and naming conventions that we'll be using for our assets and collections. So for example, if we're doing a collection on Mexican cinema, the abbreviation here would reflect that. For subjects, using initials or first initial last name creates an easy identifier, in this case, for actress Katie Jurado. So you'll notice that if you look down a couple of lines past the actors and director, we've got the 1927 Academy Awards, and the automatic inclination would be to put the number first and then the event. One of the issues that you're going to run into is, because most file systems are alpha-based, putting the number at the beginning is going to qualify that as the alpha listing as opposed to the letter designation. So you'll notice the abbreviation is Academy A 1927. And if you're doing any kind of file sorting, that'll sort all of your Academy A's and by the years you're using them, you know, in this this sequential order. So it's thinking about it in those ways that you want to consider your legend as part of the larger issue of a naming schema. Okay, so go forward. Thank you. The second worksheet I want to look at here is the file status worksheet. So once you've determined your legend, you want to move on to the second worksheet. Here, as you read the columns from left to right, you'll see that the first four columns are about elements of the file that define it for us here. And here we have what collection the file is in, the original file name, the accession date, which here we're thinking of as the date you captured it off of the internet, and then of course the URL. This is going to be very handy when you're working in Timeline because this is the information you're going to need to apply to Timeline. You'll notice the second set of columns is about usage. How have you gotten your permissions? Where's it going to go? And then the very last field, additional notes you might have about the asset. In this first note, in the first record, we see that there's a conversion that has to take the asset and convert it from a PDF to a JPEG. So think about the file status worksheet as your cheat sheet, as your way of knowing what's happening to the data that you have. And when you end up with a lot of data, and you can end up with a lot of data on these sites, this at least gives you a chance to know what's where and what's going on with it. So the last thing I want to talk about is something very specific to film research sites, especially material that you're going to be pulling from your own Media History Digital Library. So the Media History Digital Library gives you two ways to access film, stream only and download option. So here we're looking at the stream only option. And the way you know that it's a stream only option is that on the right-hand side, you'll see that it indicates stream only and as part of the definition of how you can filter the different films. And that stream only is a view only capability. Now, doesn't mean you can't use it. It just means you have to think of a different way to use it. And in this case, it would be a link in content that would then take you to this viewing screen. So you could still use it. It's just that it's not something that you can embed into Timeline or Omeka in any kind of software that it's viewable on your own resource. The second access point is download options. And you'll see that this is different because on the right side of the screen, you see a series of choices how to download the film. So what you want to do is select the type of media that you want to display, in this case, on your Timeline.js site. Again, Lorraine's going to talk more about this. But if we select the first choice, we'll be sent to a viewer with a URL that ends in the file extension that we need, in this case, .mp4. With this URL, we can embed an asset into Timeline.js. And so I'm going to go back and show you two slides prior on our file status page that the entry for Baja California, which has the original file name listed, shows you that MP4 is the file extension that is applied when you click on that download option. And you'll see in the URL that the end of the URL ends with that particular file name and extension. And then you'll be able to embed it into your own Timeline.js. So that's pretty much the overview I wanted to offer at this point. And again, I'll be able to answer more questions about this after the workshop. I'm going to move over to the next slide, which I hope I can do. Why is it not letting me? Okay, it's fighting me. Well, wait. Okay, so here we're going to take a 5-minute break. It is 2:57, so we're going to come back at about 3:02-ish. And in the meantime, we would love for you to create, if you haven't already, your free account on omeka.net and make a copy of the Timeline.js spreadsheet so that when we come back, we can then go into the workshop portion of the format. Thank you.
Thank you, Linda.
Oh, you're welcome. Turning this back over, which means I'm trying to click on a lot. Okay, I'm getting out, and I'm hope this you. Do you have access now? You good? Okay.
Good. Yeah. So we went ahead and shared a few some of the links that we had on there. They're inside that Bitly document. So please feel free. Everything that we've been talking about is in those. In the resources and DH links. So, you know, please feel free to look through any of that stuff and we'll see you guys in 5 minutes.
Sounds good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I see we have a message from Riel about the Timeline.js spreadsheet. If anyone else is looking for it, I had this experience too. You go to the webpage and you think like, where's the spreadsheet? But there is a button that lets you, that takes you to the download. That it's maybe an example of not the greatest design because the user doesn't really think they're going to be downloading anything. But there's a way to do it. And if others are running into that issue too, then maybe we can share a screen and go through that together.
Well, I have the direct link. That will be great if you can do that. Sorry about that.
Oh yeah, no problem. This is why it's nice that we're here together in real time in a workshop and not just watching YouTube. Although if you're watching this in the recorded version, we welcome you too, and we're glad you're watching this days or weeks or months later.
Gloria, are you walking us through it?
Oh, sorry, I'm on mute. I just put the direct link in there, but yeah, I can show you. It's on that.
Can you show?
Yeah, hold on. I'm having trouble moving my screen.
I got it up. Okay. All right.
Yeah.
Go ahead. She's got it.
Yeah. So if you clicked on that Timeline.js link right here where it says make a timeline, it says get the spreadsheet template. Click on that and then just make a copy.
So when you get your stuff ready, maybe Linda can go through it slowly.
Yeah, and I put the direct link in the chat too. If you just click on that last link that I shared, you got it.
Yeah, in the chat, there's a timeline spreadsheet. And if you click on that, it'll open up a new session of the Google Doc. So just click on what's in the chat and it'll open up in your own Google Drive workspace, a new version of the. Oh no, it's still saying make a copy. So you still have to do that second step where you have to make a copy. So it's going to take you to copy document so that you don't actually edit the original document. So you're going to make a copy. So it is a two-step process. You're going to make a copy and then it'll open up as a copy of the document. So think about two steps. Get the spreadsheet template. It'll take you to the Google Docs page. And then it'll say in a very small blue box, make a copy. Click on that, make a copy, and it'll open up the new copy for you. I don't know. I guess I can share my screen. Hold on.
Yes.
I can do that.
Awesome. Hold on.
Gonna go back and do that again. Hold on.
All right.
Here we are. So it takes you to a screen that looks like this. Oh, whoops.
Wait, okay. You're not sharing.
Pick
yet.
A screen. Pick you're a screen, sharing. Any screen. Hold
you're
on. I'm trying to. Hold on. I'm trying to. You are screen sharing. Okay. Is it showing me now? Can you see my? Okay. So I'm going back to Timeline.js. I'm actually going to close that. Are you seeing my Timeline.js now? So I'm going to click on Spreadsheet Template, and it's going to take me to this screen. It says it wants to make a copy, and this, of course, protects the original document from Timeline.js. So that's one of the reasons they're asking us to do that. So I'm going to click on Make a Copy, and then it's going to open. It's waiting for Google Docs, and you'll see that it opens up a new session. Again, this is how you know that we're looking at my session. There's my icon in the corner. It's not shared with anybody, but this is now my copy of the Timeline.js template. I believe you can change the name, right, Lorena?
Yes, you can.
So here is an opportunity for you to change your name to My Project. which I'm going to do right now, my project, Timeline JS3 template. And of course, it's telling you right next to that, that it's storing it in your drive. So you know where it is. Mm-hmm. And then of course you can do your own asset management. If you want to add, you notice that in the timeline, it's going to add more rows. You want to add more rows. You don't want to add 1,000. You want to add like 10. Mm-hmm. And it'll add 10 more rows that so that you can do entries. I think Elena is going to go through this. But yeah, that's it's not, yeah, it's a little less complicated. It's confusing. I agree. But I understand, you know, the Timeline JS is trying to protect the original document, which is probably why they do that. So again, I'll do it one more time.
Get the spreadsheet. Are there any other questions?
Make a copy. Bam, there it is.
Change the name, Linda.
Oh, change the name. Yes. Yes. Okay. My project. Timeline JS3. And I think you can even take the template out. You just don't, now, calling it my project or whatever you're going to call it. Oh, you know what? For the purposes of this, Mexican cinema. We'll just keep it all the same. So there's my Mexican cinema timeline JS3. Now I'm going to close it because it saved it, right? So I'm going to go into my drive. And because it's a recent document, it should show up somewhere near the top. And there it is. So here, actually the last couple of ones I've created, and I can open it here. At the top of my, that is a nice thing about Google Drive is that the recent work you do is at the top of the screen to give you thumbnails of the last things you've edited. So if you, you know, just wanted to go ahead and pull it and save it and use it later, it's right there in your drive at the top of the screen because it's a recent document that you've created. Okay, any other questions? Or I'm gonna stop sharing my screen now if I can figure out how to actually do that.
You know, before we jump into creating our own timelines here, if I could just briefly make a couple of acknowledgments. So I've now had a chance to look more thoroughly through our room of participants, and I want to give special shout outs and thank yous to Lara Isabel Cerna, Nicholas Poppy, and Riel Nowitzki, who've been just absolutely integral in bringing together this collaboration between Media History Digital Library and Recovery. Thank you all. And in addition to helping to bring us together and be part of what's facilitated this workshop, Riel, Nick, and Lara have also helped identify Spanish language and Portuguese language magazines that we are in the process of scanning. So we've set up a new collaboration with the New York Public Library, which has tremendous collections, and we are in the process of scanning some magazines that I think are going to add a tremendous amount of value to the collection, and we wouldn't be adding them without Nick, Laura, and Riel. So thank you. And as we're getting going here again, I'll also just acknowledge some of the work that Linda was showing comes to us from Chicago Film Archive and Rick Prellinger in terms of those examples that were part of Internet Archive, which is a framework that Media History Digital Library uses. But I also want to give credit where it's due to Rick Prellinger and Chicago Film Archive, who've also supported Media History Digital Library. So. There were great examples to pick from our frequent collaborators. In those cases, digitizing moving images, which you'll find side by side with the magazines and books from Media History Digital Library.
Yeah, you really want to think about these projects as these sort of these curated moments, right? Where you're mm-hmm. where you're taking content and the content that's speaking to these different elements, and you're creating a space that says, okay, how am I as a researcher considering these elements. So yeah, I love both of those sites and their work. I've always had, I've used Miras Aprimero a number of times because that's and the Chicago Film Archive is incredible. It's, you know, mm-hmm. All that work is amazing. I think I used duck and cover in class one time as part of being human in the digital age. I was talking about the post-Cold War, or the post-war, you know, atomic scare. And yeah, it's a wonderful way to actually think about how we consider film history and the elements of this kind of history. So yeah, I agree. This is a tremendous resource. I'm glad you did this.
Oh, well, just thank you. And yeah, we're just one small part of that ecosystem, but it takes all of us working together to make it happen.
And as Lorena prepares to do her part of the workshop, I just want to make sure that she will be feel free to continue to ask questions, and she has set it up so that there will be instances when she will stop and she will ask if there are any questions. But please feel free to raise your hand if something doesn't make sense to you, because you know we can stop and make that address that right away so that we don't continue if we have enough people who are not understanding. I think should we give people a couple more minutes? It's 3:10. Linda, when was our
Okay, so if we start at it's 3:09 now or 3:10 now. So if we start at 3:15,
just a couple of minutes, I think.
Or a couple of minutes. Okay, so then that gives Laura enough time to be able to stop.
A couple more minutes, Laura. Is that good?
Yeah, I'm ready whenever.
All right.
I'm going to drop the link in the chat for the omeka.net. I keep losing my menu for some reason.
You want the front page or the login? Oh, that one. Okay, the sign up. Okay. Oh, you do. Oh, never mind. Okay. You've got about 30 seconds, Lore. Okay? Okay.
Is everyone back? Should I go ahead and start? Okay. All right, everyone. So I'm going to start with creating an Omeka site. So I dropped the login so you can create your own site, you know, with your email. If you didn't get it right now, that's okay. You can just sit back, relax, and watch. And again, this is going to be recorded. Gabby, are you recording? I don't know if it's being recorded, so.
Yes, Laura. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Perfect.
We're rolling.
Sorry, I can't see anybody, so. So you can always come back and check that out. I also dropped this link in the workshop folder. And I guess I could also put it in the chat. This is also just kind of a step-by-step that you can use on how to create how to create a page. Why can't I get to the chat now? All right, well.
Let us do it, Laura.
Yeah, okay, thanks. All right, and so this is what your backend is gonna look like once you created your account. You're gonna click My Account and Add a Site. And once you have Add a Site, you're gonna create the subdomain name. So I created a sample one called USLDH Workshop. So that's what I called it all together. It'll be that.omeka.net. And then a site title, the title that you want to actually come out. And this can be like test. You can just do this one for testing, right? And then the description would be an actual description of the site. Again, if you're doing it right now, you can just put test. It's fine. Okay, once you do that, you can go in to manage the site. And it's gonna take you to this dashboard. And this is where you do all the work. This is all the hidden stuff. The front end will look like this. And so I've already loaded stuff in here, but yours would be blank. But this is called the back end. This is the dashboard. And so the very first thing you're gonna do is, as Linda had mentioned, you're going to organize your sources, what you're gonna put into, what data you're gonna put into the Omeka. And so of course, you're gonna go back to the Excel sheet. And so we use Google Sheets a lot, especially if we're more than one person is working on it. It's a great way to share, especially right now where we're collaborating across distance. And we create the created the sheet, which you can find again in the folder, that has these what's called Dublin core item descriptions. And these are in Omeka 2. I'll show you in a second. So you don't have to memorize these, but you could just, you know, copy them from Google Docs. You can also create this on your own. On your own or on your own machine, like on your own laptop, you can just use Excel or you can use numbers. And you're going to start categorizing the items that you're gonna put into Omeka. So for example, we have these four items here and we organize, these are newspaper articles from recovery collections. I got the title. This is just like the title of the article. The creators, that's the author. So sometimes you know the author and then sometimes you don't. So this one is unknown. This is not the person who is creating the data. So it's the author or the photographer or the artist. A short description, just the way you do in library descriptions. You know, you don't want to give them a whole essay. You just want to kind of give them a little morsel so that they know what this is about. Subject, the subject headings are Library of Congress subject headings. So we get these from the Library of Congress website where you can actually search. So you might have to do a little bit of research to figure out which subject headings fit your item best. Date, and you're gonna decide for your own project how you're going to display the date. Here I did month, date, year, but on our official Omeka, we actually have year, month, date. Type, is it a text? Is it a still image? Is it a video? And the format is what the file format is. Is it a PDF? Is it a JPEG? Is it a MP4, etc. Now the identifier is something that you're gonna have to come up with. You're gonna come up with a standard for your whole collection. I know sometimes when we save files on our computer, we come up with, you know, these really long names and they're not necessarily standard. I mean, if you think about all the PDFs you save, all your articles, how are you naming them? Are they a random number? Are they the title? Are they the author? You have to come up with something standard. And so for this one, because we call this the Film and Press Collection, I'm calling it FIP, and I'm giving it this long number. So this is the first one, this is the second one, this is the third one, so that I know that all of these are related. These are all part of the same collection. If I had a different collection, I would come up with a different identifier number. So I'd come up with like a different code to use to abbreviate. So this is completely up to you. You will have to create a standard. And I strongly suggest while you're doing this, and this is something we do at Recovery all the time, is write a journal. Keep a daily or weekly journal where you document all these decisions. So we decided to name files according to this pattern. And then the source is where that comes from. So you want to let people know where they can find the original. This one was from La Prensa, which is the San Antonio newspaper, and it is in Redux, which is part of Newsbank. It's called America's Historical Newspapers by Recovery. So I want to point people in that direction. I've got the language. If it's an image, you might not have a language, so you can just leave it blank. And the publisher is the original publisher of this newspaper article was La Prensa. If I had a secondary author, if I had a translator, I would include them under contributor. Sometimes we'll have like legal documents where someone prepared the legal document and then another person like co-signed it. So they would be a contributor because they're not the main author. Relation is, if there is another document or another item that is related to this item, so if I had a pair of letters, maybe one receiving and the response, I would probably put that here because I want people to look at the other letter too. If you're using something from the motion picture archive, you want to point them in the direction of that larger archive too. If there was a collection in special collections, then I would include that here so that they know, like whoever's looking at it knows where to find it, but also yourself, like maybe you don't have a good scan of it and you're like, oh, where did I find this? You want to be able to know where to turn back to. Coverage is the physical location that's mentioned or geographic location. So is this about San Antonio? Is it about Houston, Texas? Is it about Texas in general? It just kind of is another way to enter into that text or to give people an idea what that text or item is about. Now, tags are keywords. You would come up with your own way of doing this as well. For us, we've decided to use the tags to include Spanish and include things that are left out of the Library of Congress subject headings. So sometimes we don't find something that really describes an item, especially when you're working with underrepresented archives. You'll notice that the Library of Congress tends to be very Eurocentric, very American focused, very Anglo-English centered. And so maybe you don't find something that really describes your item, but you want people to still find it. This helps with discoverability. Again, you decide how you want to create those tags. What are, maybe you want to come up with like the list ahead of time of tags that you would use. And so this one, for example, I did cine, which is film in Spanish. And then the rights are important too. You need to give credit to whoever owns the rights to that. Okay, so do I have any questions with the Google spreadsheet?
So far, no. I haven't seen.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay, so once I have that, I'm going to, oops, I'm in the wrong one. I'm actually going to download this. I would make a CSV sheet. If you're doing it in Excel or in Numbers on your laptop, the same thing, you would want to save it as a CSV. And what's really important about this is that it tells the computer how to read the values in the cells. Because it's a CSV, that means you cannot use semicolons in your document because the computer will read a semicolon as a row. So for example, this one, motion pictures, This one, Isabella Corona, has two subject headings. So I'm going to actually use semicolons here purposefully because I want the computer to know, or Omeka to know, that these are two separate entries under subject. If I put a semicolon in the description, it would create two description fields rather than one sentence. Okay. So once I have that, I'm gonna set it up here. I'm gonna use the CSV import. And this is a plugin that comes with Omeka, so you can actually choose what plugins that you can activate or not activate. I strongly recommend CSV import because if you're working with like 100 documents, it's a lot easier to upload your CSV versus adding stuff individually. I think I skipped ahead of myself, and I apologize. I have, just so you know which ones I used, I installed the CSV import, the exhibit builder, the LC suggest, which is Library of Congress for the subject headings, gives you like a drop down. And I did simple pages, which means I can add additional pages on the front end of the site. But you can play with them. There's descriptions on the Omeka page. Unfortunately, they don't have like live views of them, but you can look at their gallery and see other sites that are using these different plugins. If you did the paid site, or if you did a larger Omeka site where you downloaded it onto a server, you could actually have access to more plugins than this. All right, so I'm gonna show you that Dublin Core.
Lore, can yes. I just say like, this is a perfect time to become very friendly with your librarian who might be a digital humanities specialist or digital specialist, start identifying who these people are at your university. We create a list of all these people at our university so that whenever people reach out to us, we can put them in touch with them, establish a relationship with them. And also tutorials. There's the Q&A, the how to troubleshoot, right? And Omeka has that, and they're very responsive. Anything else, Lore or Linda?
There's a question. The question is if you want to add pieces manually or individually, is CSV still suggested? It's a very good question.
If you were going to do them manually, I would do them manually. Which I've done as well. I've done like a big group and then I've had to go back and do individual ones. So I think it's better to do it individually, but I would still add it to your CSV so that you can have it all together. So it still needs to be on your CSV. You need to keep that CSV. That's great for you knowing where everything is, what all the data is, in case there's, I don't know, some huge disaster and you like lose data, like if you did have it on a server. So the one that I had y'all sign up for is in the cloud, but the one that we have, we actually downloaded it. We bought a server and downloaded it on there so that we would have more space and that it would be in-house. So that's a decision that you would make. So I would strongly suggest doing them individually if you were just gonna add like one or two. And it's not a big deal if you're just doing, you know, three or four, you can do them individually, but I would still suggest creating that as the CSV. The one thing about the CSV is sometimes CSVs cause hiccups sometimes because if you're using Excel, you can't put in accents because once you turn that Excel sheet into a CSV, it'll garble it. If you have a Mac and you use numbers, it will keep your accents. So that's one thing to keep in mind. I've also had issues where I download, it actually happened recently, where I downloaded, you know, this one from a Google, and it was causing errors because even though there's nothing over here, the computer thought there was something in these cells. And so all I did was, you know, highlight them and hit delete, and then it worked. So sometimes there's a little bit of troubleshooting, and that's definitely something that, as Gabby mentioned, you can look on the Omeka forum and post a question, or, you know, check to see if anybody has posted about it. So one thing about the digital humanities for pretty much any software is always Google it, always check on YouTube and see if you can find the answer, because so many people have probably already posted about that. And then there were also lots of tutorials out there as well. So I didn't know anything about Omeka. I learned a lot, like most of it, from Googling, from looking at the forum, and then just playing with it. And I was lucky enough to work with a librarian who volunteered with us. And so she really helped with our determination of how to come up with these different, like what our standard was going to be for, like, how did we write the date, or how did we come up with titles, and, you know, use that in addition to the kind of recovery protocols that we already had going. So it's a great way to learn about these library standards as well. And so if you go to dashboard, I can show you how to add an item individually. And I'm gonna go through this a lot slower in a second. But if I add an item, here is where I can do it individually, and I get these text boxes where I can type in. And you can see up at the top, where it tells you it's Dublin Core. It also has a link to more information about Dublin Core. So I invite you to click on that and you can read it, and they give you definitions and examples of what these different metadata element sets are. And Omeka already gives you like a little brief description here about what this is. So those are like two ways to research it. So if I were importing it from the CSV, the computer's going a little slow. I would click on CSV, I would have that active in the plugins. And then all I need to do is browse and look for the, let me find it. I would look for the CSV, open it, I would see it here. And you need to do the CSV upload in Firefox. So I've noticed it doesn't work in Chrome and it doesn't work in Safari. And I would select a collection, so I've created a collection. And I don't think that the default is set this way, but it's basically one comma and the rest are semicolons. And I'm not gonna go through it, but I would, because it might take a second. I put next, and then it would show me the status. And then I would like refresh this page, because it will tell me if it's queued or if it's in progress. And then I can just hit refresh and it'll tell me if it's completed. It'll also tell me any errors, like if it skipped items or skipped rows. If it skipped something, that means there's an error with the data, so you have to go back and check. And then you can also undo imports as well. Individual items. So I'm gonna go to one of these. I'll go to this one. So I got this one from the Media History Project. And I'll show you how I did that. So I go here and then I can look for anything here. So you can browse through the collection, but if you also search, you'll find a list of JPEGs. Okay, usually the thumbnail pops up. I think my computer.
Yeah, sorry about that. No, that's not your computer. Oh. The Internet Archive changed some things over on their servers, so we're playing catch up. Okay. And the beautiful thumbnails, some of them have been temporarily missing, but mark my words, they're coming back.
Okay, no worries then.
But there's ways, but actually, this is good in a way, because I know this is happening to other users too. And so Lorena, could I suggest in that case you try clicking on what says read in context?
Yes.
There, okay. And then when you're inside the book reader, mm-hmm. All you need to do is right click on a page mm-hmm. and you can save that image.
Oh, great.
Or copy it, yeah.
Okay, and then I'll save it as a JPEG?
That's right. That's
wonderful. Right. Okay, so then there's the way around it. Thank you so much for...
Yeah, no, I mean, it's... I'm so glad that our search engine is kind of temporarily broken in some ways, so I could make that point.
Yeah, no, that's great. And I know you can also download the PDF. So, and this mm-hmm. is like wonderful. I mean, that's another example of how sometimes you don't know how to do something and you can reach out and somebody else knows how to do it. So thank you so much. So I would copy and save that. I'm not, and let's see. All right, so here's where I see all my metadata that was uploaded with the CSV. If I were going to add it manually, I would just type it in. And then if you have more than one thing, you actually have to add input here to get another text box. If you put it here with commas, it'll just be like a long list and you need them to separate out because they're different subject headings. And so once I have all the metadata in, I'm gonna add the file. So you go to add to files and then I would browse, I would look for the file and then I would just add it. So I've already, and then it'll show up like this. And then save page, save changes. And then I can decide whether I'm gonna make this public or if I'm gonna make this featured. Usually, if you're still working on something, you probably wanna keep everything private until you're ready to publish it. So it's really easy, just toggle on off, and then you can add it to a collection. If you're working on a collection, you create collections the exact same way that you create an item. You just add the collection and then you're gonna add all the metadata for that collection. And the same thing here, you can make it public or you can feature it. Feature just means it puts it in a more prominent location. Let me see if I can show you. So here's, this is as a feature item. If I didn't have a featured item, it would just be blank. I could pick a different item as a featured item. You can only have one featured item and one featured collection or exhibit at a time. So this is something that you can circulate. All right. And then this is definitely a great student project that can take place throughout the entire semester. It's basically project-based learning because they would be learning about metadata. They would be learning how to do research and how to collect data, how to organize these assets, and then how to use Omeka itself, as well as like how to curate a collection, because you know, you can't always put 1,000 things online unless you know you have the funding. But if you're a student and you're creating like a small project, then you might be limited. You'll have like a professor you can, or educator, you can let your class know you need to create 40 items and the CSV sheet, and you have to fill out all the metadata. And of course, sometimes you don't have, like I said, sometimes there's a few things that are missing. You might not know the creator, or you might not know the date. It's okay to leave those blanks. But that's just kind of like one of the scaffold things. You could create the first, start deciding what you want to do the research on. Two, start doing the research, start looking on the databases for these images, and then start making the CSV, create your Omeka site, start uploading the items. All right, do I have any questions right now?
Oh, come on. Oh, no, you're good. I thought I was muted. Okay.
All right, so now I'm gonna show you an exhibit. And then after this, I'm gonna have you walk you through slowly so that you can, if you have an Omeka site, you can follow me to add an item. So an exhibit, so if you think of like a collection as a museum, you walk into the museum, you see this specific collection, maybe by a specific artist, right? The context is limited usually because they'll have like the little placards on the side of the art piece that tells you the title and the date and what it's made out of. Basically, it tells you all the metadata, right? But you could get a docent to contextualize the collection for you, to tell you a little bit more about the artist, who they were, what the style is, what these different pieces mean, what is happening historically, that sort of thing. So an exhibit can do that. You can select a smaller number of the items in your collection and write basically a digital essay about them that explains it. So the Balas y Rugidos, one that Carolina mentioned earlier, is an exhibit. There is a collection that has several things in the Leonor Villegas de Magnon collection. And then an exhibit that tells us more about her life and her importance for the Mexican Revolution and her connections with Mexican revolutionary leaders. And so that's the kind of more essay, more academic, like scholarly essay type writing happens there. And so if you've added the exhibit builder on plugins, you'll have access to this. And this is also another point and click. I would add an exhibit. I started one right here. So I'm gonna edit this. This is what you would find if you clicked add. So I'd come up with the title, and then I would come up with the slug. Now, a slug is the end of your URL. It's that back end of that link that changes based on what page you are. So it's kind of like a page name that the computer uses. So you want to come up with something short. You don't want to put any spaces. You don't want to put any special characters. Your user might not even notice what the slug is. So you could use like page one, page two. Here I'm going to use film for this exhibit because I know like if I see that, I'll know this is related to the film in the US Latino press. Credits is where you're going to put your name or whoever the author is of this exhibit. So if you had a student or a group of students, maybe they each write their own exhibit. They could write their name there. And then a short description. You know, you probably want to do more than one sentence. I just typed up something really quickly, but, you know, like a short paragraph here so that people know what they're going to find in this exhibit. And then tags. These can be Library of Congress subject headings. These can be the tags that you invented. Again, this is something that you would decide or you would have your students come up with the theoretical, like the reasoning behind coming up with these lists of tags that they're going to use, because people can browse by tag. So you want something that is descriptive and interesting to pull them in. Theme is just what it looks like. So I can change it to, I can set public theme. That means that if I change the colors of the whole site, the exhibit is going to use the same colors, or maybe I want it to look a little different from the whole site, so then I could switch it to something different. And this is just what page is your exhibit going to start on? Is it going to start on this summary page, or is it just going to start on page one? So it's up to you. And then a cover image, you're going to choose an image from the collection that, you know, best exemplifies it, because it'll be the thumbnail. And then you add pages, and this is also just point and click. And so I've already added one page. I'm going to add another page here. And I'm going to come up with the page title, whatever is related to that. Menu title is just what's going to appear, what the person's going to see. So you might want it to be the same thing. It's up to you. And then you get to pick the content block. This is what that page is going to look like. You can have a file with text. You can have a gallery, which means you have several images. You can have just text or just a file. So I'm just going to click file with text, add a new content block. And if I click on add item, I can look at all the items that I have uploaded to this, to my Omeka. So I'll pick this one. And you can provide a caption. So article, Vanessa Vela Corona in La Prensa. So I want to put something descriptive there. And this is where I write, you know, whatever I'm going to write on this page. So this would be, this is information about the history. Of course, it would be a little longer. I'm going to save this. I could save it and add a different page if I wanted to. But I want to see what it looks like. So I can hit public page. I'm going to start from the beginning. So this was the description page. And then I can go to my first page. And then here's that second page that I added. So of course this would be more. And then if you had like images, right here I have a text image, but you know, you could have photographs here. And it would just, you know, you can customize the way you want it to display, like I said, with the gallery. So I can show you a few examples on the recovery site.
Lori, as you're doing that, can I interject quickly? Just to check with people, how are you feeling? You guys doing okay? I think we are at 45 more. We have 45 more minutes. Thank you. 45 more minutes. Thank you to all who have responded. 45 more minutes of our workshop. So we just want to make sure that I think we have in Lorena's presentation of Omeka, there's an exercise. I don't know if you want if you all want to do that, or if you prefer that she jumps into timeline and walk us through that now, so that we're not rushed. If you timeline.
Yeah, timeline could be good, because then we if there's more time at the end, we can come back to Omeka. But like Lorena pointed out too, Omeka is so widely used that it's really well documented. And so I think, let's take a look at timeline.
Yeah, sure. And then this, I just want to show you this quick example of what an exhibit looks like. Is the Norviegas and Magnon one. Right. So it looks, the different pages look different. And then this is the opportunity for her to really just elaborate on why this collection is important.
Yeah, like Lore says, this has been very useful for our classes, as you can see in some of the assignments that we shared with you all, especially for like writing classes that have like the writing intensive requirement. Students get to practice, you know, their skills in editing and thinking about writing in a very specific way that is not necessarily, I mean, they don't write like a short blog, but they write a little piece that's a little bit more informed with a bibliography. And one thing that we didn't mention here is the protocols page. In every single one of our projects, we include a protocol page that is based on collections of as data work that Tomás Padilla has been working on. We share the link on there to document the work of all collaborators, students, people who scanned, people who wrote anything, people who did all kinds of different things for this project are credited in this protocol. Libraries, collections that are listed, etc.
That's such a great practice for all of us to incorporate in this work, I think, because so often that labor just goes invisible.
Yeah, and that's also part of that definition for digital humanities. That a lot of times we think, oh, it has to be like a finalized digital humanities project that is getting reviewed and that is, you know, being shared with everyone. But it's also, there are so many different steps and each person contributes in a very specific way that we, a lot of times we don't get to see the final end product. And so we for us, it's extremely important to document that. Yes, Cara.
If I might add something that really, I use Omeka for a project, for a final project for, with my students. They had to work with the project the whole semester. And one of it was an incredible experience because they had the opportunity to choose the research topic. They got very involved with the project because they had to do it. And they had to work with librarians, with archivists, with archives, sometimes scanning materials, you know, doing all their research. So it's a great opportunity to involve the students, actively involve the students, especially if you're gonna be teaching, not in an actual class, you know. It's a way to for them to feel that they're involved and that they're creating content. So it was a really great experience for my class.
Yeah, and if your library has an Omeka page, this might be the opportunity to ask them if your students can contribute to it, or they can make their own, or you can make a class one. And so some of Caro's students decided that they wanted to contribute to our recovery Omeka, so that they were contributing to something that would be public facing. Okay, so I'm gonna move on to timeline. So if you haven't gotten your timeline template, you could do that now. It's down at the bottom. If you click on make a timeline, it'll take you straight to it. This is one example up here, and there are several examples right here as well. Linda and I threw together one specific to this, just so that you could see one with film archives on it and just different things. And this is something that you can interact with. You can include images, you can include Google Maps. You can see these are single points, and we also have some that are a little span more time. You can include audio, and this is what Linda talked about earlier, that she was able to find audio and video on the Library of Congress to embed. This is video from YouTube. This is an image from Wikipedia. So as a reminder, Wikipedia and Wiki Commons, even though we don't want students to use them for writing their reports, they can get free images from there because these images are free use. And then this one I was able to pull from the Media History Digital. Typo there.
It's a mouthful. It's okay. Digital History Library Media. You can put it in any order.
All right. Well, there's one. So this is a JPEG image, and you can see that we've got it cited and also have a caption. And so this is the image, the media. This is the media. You call it rights. And then this is the caption. This is the headline. This will be the text, and this is the date displayed. And if you want, you can delete the date. You can put like page one on page two on here instead. We can also use embed videos from the Internet Archive, Library of Congress, Vimeo. So there's a wide range of things, including Instagram and YouTube. So if you have downloaded your timeline spreadsheet, you'll see that it's already got everything set up for you. So this is what is powering that timeline that you just saw that I made, Linda and I made here. So you don't need to know any code. you just need to know how to type into Excel here. And so this is where you include the year, the month, and the date that you want pinpointed on that timeline. And so it has year and end year in case you want to have a range. So if it's something that took place over several years, you could do that here. If it happened just on a certain date, you can put the exact date on there. And then that's where that headline that I told you, the kind of bold, larger one comes there. This first one doesn't have a year because it's just the title slide that tells you like, this is a timeline, and you would say like film history or whatever that timeline is about. All right. Text is what is displayed after that. We wouldn't recommend writing too much because you don't want to have a whole essay on each slide. And this is something you would be really specific about for students. You would probably tell them, I want this many slides. And you need to write about, you know, 2 to 4 sentences or 2 to 6 sentences per text slide box. Media. This is the URL. So you need a URL. That means that the image needs to live online. You need to be able to get this link somewhere. So that's why I was able to get the, where's the Wikipedia one? Here we go. I click on that, I'll show you. I looked up Katie Jurado. Let's go to Wikipedia. Let's look up Katie Jurado. There we go. And I have this image here. I click on it. I like to click on the second one because it's usually a little bit bigger. And then up here, you can see the link that you can copy. Notice that it ends in .jpg. It needs to end in .jpg or .png in order for it to use it. There are a few occasions where I've seen that it works that it doesn't have a .jpeg, like on Instagram. But usually if you just do a Google image search, they switch something up. Since we were just talking about the Internet Archive changing things, Google just changed things on their image search so it doesn't end in JPEG. So you would have to click on it and visit the actual site where you can find it. You copy that, and then you go to your spreadsheet, and then you would just paste it there. Always remember to include the media credit and a media caption that describes what's going on in the picture. And you can leave everything else just over here. You don't have to do anything with this. Same thing with YouTube. If you found an image or a video and you would probably want to describe to your students like what an appropriate video length is, you would just copy the URL and then paste it there. The timeline will appear in chronological order. So if you actually wrote 1925, 2000, 1939, it'll still order it correctly. Okay, do I have any questions?
Yes, yes you do. Okay. So the question is, what happens if a link disappears? So what do you, you know, what's the best practice to?
Well, if the link disappears, it'll be a broken link, so it's not gonna show up. So you would have to, you know, find another image. If you created entries in Omeka, for example, then you would have more control and you would, you know, have that stable URL that you could use. So it really depends on where you're getting your links from. If you're doing like a class project, then maybe it doesn't matter as much because of the like long term. So I think like if you're using images on personal websites, then there is a higher chance of those disappearing. You could pull images from the Internet Archive. Those are longer sustainability. So think about where you're getting those images from. I think that that's really important, and I'll tell you kind of like what the chances are of them disappearing versus if it's like somebody's Angel Fire blog or something that'll pop up.
So we have another question.
In a personal page, would you recommend to make a copy of that, like you said, and dump it in a collection in Omeka? So like you said, you would have control of it?
I think it depends on what that image is. So if it's in a personal page and it's a personal photo, then you were gonna have to ask for permission. If it's something that is like Creative Commons, you can ask them if they can, you can put in your Omeka. If it's like something from the Library of Congress that is free use, then you could put it in your Omeka and just make sure that you say where it comes from, say that it's a Library of Congress free use image.
So I have another question.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So can you integrate the timeline into Omeka? I have a question.
Yes. I will get to that in a second. But thanks for asking that. Yeah, because I had been experimenting and just found out that it does. And so you can embed it into an exhibit. So if you were writing an exhibit, like if you had the collection for Lupe Vélez, for example, you know, you had letters, you had images, you had articles, and then you want to have a timeline of her life, you can have the exhibit, you know, talk about her importance, her role in film, and then you can have the timeline in there as well. So once you have all this set up, you're gonna wanna save this, publish to web. And these instructions are also on the Timeline.js web page. So if I click publish to web, you're gonna click entire document and then click on OD1. And it's giving me the option to stop publishing because I already published it. But let me see, can't scroll down. Oh, so it would tell you save here and publish and give you that option. And then you don't have to do anything with this. Ignore this URL. Just save it, click X. And then you see this URL up at the top, the link, you're gonna wanna copy that. And then you're gonna wanna go back to the original Timeline.js webpage. And here where it says that make a timeline that actually guided you through. And if you want another template, you can get another template. Right? And here's the example of how to publish to web. See, you would get the green button. So you copy, I already copied that link. And then this is where you can drop in that URL for the link for the timeline Excel sheet. And then it automatically gives you a link here. So this is the link you can share. This is the link that you would have your student share with you. If you're doing an assignment, I would suggest that you get your students to send you the link to their Google Doc or their Google Sheet and the link to the timeline. That way, if something happens, so if you see at the very top of this page, it said that they had a problem on April 29th and the timelines weren't showing up. And that's the exact day that I had student projects due. And so I couldn't see their timeline and they were freaking out. But I was still able to grade it because I saw the Excel sheet, and then luckily Timeline or Night Lab fixed it by the next day and so it was fine. But this, if I copy this link, this is gonna be the same one as this. But it'll load the timeline here. If I want to embed it in a website or Omeka, then I can use this one that says embed. It uses what's called an iframe. You see that here? That means it puts a website inside another website. So you can copy that. And if I go to my exhibit here, this was one of the pages that I made with y'all. I have to go to where it says source code. And then I just paste it in there. Okay, I save that. I'm gonna view that. And then I can see my timeline in here. So that's it. Do I have questions at this moment?
No, I don't see any new questions. The thing I wanted to add was that this is sort of a real-time process, right? So if you make any more changes on that original, your timelines, your spreadsheet that you were creating, and you refresh the timeline that you're viewing, it will show them. It's an immediate, it's a real-time kind of a thing, so.
So I could just refresh here, any changes I make.
The nice thing about that is if you catch a spelling error as you're looking at this, and inevitably you will, you'll be looking at this finished product and it's like, wow, I have two the's in here. How did anybody miss that? You're able to go back in and automatically make those corrections on timeline, which is really a nice feature that it is all in real time.
Yeah, so I'll put here film example timeline. And then I'm going to refresh this and then I'll see here.
Yeah, it's immediate.
Yeah. I didn't go into this, but you can change the background with the hex code. All you need to do is Google hex code and you'll find colors. As long as you put the pound and the 6-digit number, you can change that color. And it says so, it tells you here, I think. Or maybe it doesn't. Oh, here on their help docs.
Yeah. It's impressive how powerful it is, but also like very lightweight.
Right.
And it keeps the frameworks so open too. Like I remember this old school like timeline software that came on CD-ROMs and then DVD-ROMs, and it was proprietary and mm-hmm. it would walk you through a whole lot of menus. And in this case, there's, you know, I can imagine for students like a temporary moment or initial moment of maybe like discomfort or confusion. I'm entering things into this Google sheet. What does that have to do with the timeline? But mm-hmm. what you've just guided us through so nicely is, yeah, a really like fluid and powerful process where, unlike those old CD-ROM timeline things too, it's not going to be locked up in some kind of software programming language. Like here it remains a CSV, which is completely transportable.
The other thing is it's immediate in that if the link isn't working, there's nothing there. So as you're looking at this published timeline, there'll be just a little, you know, an icon like when an image is missing that lets you know that there's something wrong with your URL, either that the extension isn't correct or that, you know, an asset's been moved into another directory and that the directory you have is no longer the directory that you can use. And so
and we included sample assignments in the timeline in the folder. So you can see our examples. This pairs really nicely with the writing exercise. So you can either do like a traditional research paper writing or a reflective writing, which has the students really reflect on the experience. They can talk about what they liked, what they didn't like, but also the experience of learning something new that they can actually transfer and use in their other classes, because it's something that they can use for a project. It's a great alternative to the, you know, like the PowerPoint presentation, because it's much more interactive. It's something that you can share. You can share online. Anything else? I know, like, I think our students were super excited to learn how to use it. And so, I mean, yeah. I don't know if Gabby has some feedback on that too.
Yeah, absolutely. I think more than anything, the, you know, learning to participate in this digital world in a way where that it's very engaging to new users, right? And to understand that the power of bringing materials from the past, right? And to see like how empowered they are into curating and organizing and thinking. And I always tell my students, think of this as maybe like the only instance in which this item from the archive will get to see like the light of day. So it is like on I feel bad for them, but it is like the responsibility is on their shoulders to think about if you're curating this. So what would you do to make this available and visible to the thousands of people that are looking and shifting through websites, and then this is the only opportunity that they'll have to look at a specific picture of Katy Jurado, right? How would you frame it? What do you do to make that, you know, make that it stand out? and they understand the value of the virtual world. They understand the value of digital humanities for this. They start to understand how the technology doesn't have to be scary, and it can be extremely useful, especially as a source for social justice, to create spaces for communities that have been underrepresented. We always talk about a lot about erasure of the of voices who are not English speakers. And so I think it's in that sense, it's extremely useful and very empowering.
So we have a question.
Sure.
Sorry, oh, I wasn't sure my mic was on. So we have the question, if you're working with your own collection of images, et cetera, are there any rights issues to be aware of before working in Omeka?
That's a tough question. Answer.
How private can your work be? It's the end of the question. So my question back was, is this about the public life of assets? Because, you know, that is a broader question that we all should think about in terms of how we're publishing it and what we already are thinking about it at USLDH and what we are publishing. And
yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll answer the technical rights thing, but you can always create a collection and not make it public. Right. You know, you can make a collection for yourself or for your students or within the class, and then they could give you access if you were making it a class project. If you're doing it, you can also do it to store your, you know, it's not technically, what do you call it? It's not a management system. It's not like Fedora or something like that, but you could use it to store your images, right? For yourself or for like a personal family project and just give everybody access to it. You could ask if it's something that you do want to make public and you're using library resources, then like Gabi mentioned earlier, this is the time where you reach out and you talk to the people who manage that archive. If you're working with a community archive, this is the moment where you reach out and not just ask for permission, but also get them involved, right? This is an opportunity to work with communities to maybe you have access to resources that they don't. So they can get usernames, they can help create the metadata, they can help define the protocols. So I'll let Caro, if you have any other like copyright issue that you wanna add.
Well, before you, we've got one more question about copyright. Maybe this will all, you can tie this all together. The second question about copyright is if you're working with certain social media elements such as memes, we don't have to worry about copyrights, right?
So. Yeah, so you have to be very careful with copyright because you can get in trouble very easily. So if the collection, if you mean by the collection being yours that are you are the owner of the collections, like meaning from your family, for example, you shouldn't have any problems. You should think about what you want to put out there, you know, but if they're yours, you shouldn't have any problems with that. But if your collection of photographs come from your research that you did in different archives and different, you need to get permission for that. Or you need to cite. You need to recognize that these photographs, even if they are in the public domain, where you got them from. And that's really important.
So the attribution is always important. And yes. I think in terms of advising our students, one thing I encourage students is to add as much description and interpretation as possible. I mean, if you are working with, let's say, a copyrighted image, if you are analyzing it and need to have it present to make a critical point, then that's fair use. If it's one of 300 images that you've just uploaded into a collection and there's not that kind of analysis there, then it probably wouldn't qualify as a fair use.
Yeah. In terms of memes, that's a good question. You cannot, okay, copyright, you cannot, there is not copyright for titles, for like general sayings, you know, and things like that, but I have not heard about memes. I would recommend for you to go to the link that I provided for copyright is the official government a copyright page, and look if there's something in there. I wouldn't think that they will be under copyright. You know, there are so many of them out there. But just to make sure, take a look in there, just to cover your back.
Okay, so the next question, and then I'll go back to the memes one in a second, because somebody's saying.
Yeah, so nobody, they're anonymous. Exactly. They're anonymous, right? I don't think somebody took the time to do it, get copyright. But for books, for example, if they have not claimed copyright and they were published after March 1st, 1989, for example, there is a new law that says that they fall into copyright, even if they don't claim copyright. Okay.
So there's another question here about, well, what if it's not available? Well, the first question would be, what about PDFs of materials you found in some library materials, like a newspaper article? Is that, you know, what's the verdict on that? And I think you've touched a little bit about that.
Yeah, we work with the library. I would recommend work with the library. There is also always a specialist in copyright at your library, and they're really happy and willing to work with you. And if there's something in their collection, they can give you the whole information. So research about the copyright of specific things, and citation, it's very important again. But if there's something from your library, contact the librarian or archivist, and they can tell you how they would like to be cited, how that image is, should be cited, and if they has any copyright issues.
So the next question is about, is a better citation of the web page or the URL or both, or what, when doing citations?
Or, more information, I think the more information, the better. I tend to use MLA, so MLA or Chicago. So if you're using it on like Omeka, you could put the full citation. You can definitely put the full citation on Timeline.js too. Like under the media credit, you can put the full citation if it's something.
Including when you access it, which is also kind of important.
Yeah. So you don't, I mean, the URL for the media will already be there, but you can include it, like if it's coming from like an article or, you know, like from something else. You can put it in there. So I would just use like a formal citation.
Can I just always suggest, I mean, that's for best practices, keep that journal there, keep all of the, you know, a record of all the places, all the citations that you think, the sites that you've been visiting, and visit that collections as data document, because that walks you through a way to document some of these things. And always, like Lorena said, more is better in this case, right? So that you're really covering your bases in terms of how you're citing the information.
And in that regard, Gabby, that's a great point. If you go to an archive, the old way, you know, in the future, if you have been going there, you have to fill out a form that gives you information. Yeah. Keep a copy of that. Keep a folder with the copies of all the research you have done in libraries and archives. That's gonna give you a lot of information that you're gonna need later to create the final product.
So here's the question about microfilm.
Before you go there, Linda, also a lot of these places, when you visit them, they will tell you how they want you to cite your reference to your visit, right? Because we should always cite the reference to a visit, even if we don't use their resources.
You mean like special collections?
Yeah, absolutely.
They'll tell you exactly how they want you to cite their information.
Oh, yeah.
So a good rule of thumb with special collections is whatever you've taken, take a picture of that document that you have to fill out for special collections. Because one, it helps you keep track of what you got from that particular collection. And two, it also has that information about how they want you to cite it. So. And where that material came from, in what box and what collection. And so if you ever have to go back, you have that data. So always take a picture of that form you have to fill out, because that will often save you.
Yeah. We have about 10 minutes, guys.
And I was just going to say, like, on Timeline.js, either if you're creating it or you're having students create it, you can always have them create a last slide with the bibliography, just the works cited, like right. you would on a paper. Or, you know, like, if they're writing the accompanying essay with it, you know, include that bibliography. If you want it on the timeline to be the last slide, just make sure that it's the last date.
Right. And that's a good way to translate traditional scholarship onto these
thoughts. So there is another question here about the microfilm. So usually if it isn't microfilm, it's old, right? if the images, the newspapers are in the public domain, you probably can use them, you know, without asking permission. But best practices request for you to cite the place where you got the microfilm from. So who created the microfilm? If it comes from the recovery project, for example, just say that somewhere inside that the belongs to a collection from the Recovering the U.S. Hispanic Literary Heritage.
So the publisher is the microfilm producer, right?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah,
we have another question.
They pay for the microfilm. They pay for the surrogate.
Yeah,
you know.
So
is the question also about how do we incorporate files or objects, articles that aren't currently digitized? But a lot of the work we've been on today is retrieving things from databases and things that are already digitized online. Mm-hmm. This is a great question. How do we also remind students that there's lots of material that's not currently online and they should be thinking about bringing those in? I know with Omeka, having used it before, there is an option, like if you, in other words, were to scan something from microfilm or from print to upload it yourself and it can live on Omeka. Is that what others would recommend doing?
I think
all the stuff in our Omeka, on our like actual recovery Omeka, are things that we scanned. So we scan them and we put them up. We also own the rights to them. You could absolutely scan. I think Caro's class students actually did scan some material. So we worked with the actual like physical archive. So there was an archival trip involved, right, Caro?
Yes, and in one case they also used a collection that was not processed yet, so it was a real work. And the most amazing thing was that they were excited about it, you know. So it was a win-win in all senses. And the collection has evolved, and it's already almost ready to be open to the public. So it worked very well. Mm-hmm. There's another question about Omeka and Timeline. Linda, are you going to read it?
Answering it now. Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay.
You said answer if I could, and that one was an easy one. So are both Omeka and Timeline open source? Because Omeka asked us to sign up for a trial period. So I said, yes, Omeka.net is a trial period, but the annual cost is low for the pretty robust collection application. It is an annual cost that you can pay. I want to say it's, what, $20?
And some libraries do have access to Omeka. So I would consult, again,
I would ask.
I highly encourage you to check with your library to see what resources they have available.
You. Because it was initially built, if I'm remembering correctly, with the idea in mind that people would download it and then install it on their own servers.
Yeah.
But right. Of course, that's a privilege that yeah. some people at certain institutions have with good IT departments that others don't. And so Omeka.net was developed to help accommodate the many people who don't have that luxury of going to the IT person and saying, install this on our server. Right. But there is that version, if I'm remembering correctly, that you can deploy on a server if you have one.
Mm-hmm. There's a number of commercial hosting packages that have Omeka as an installation that it's easy enough to do because it's an application that you're mm-hmm. installing like WordPress or right. or any of the, but and you're paying the annual fee for the hosting. And that is actually what I use for my own research.
One more question.
And this is actually a really good question. How large a collection of PDFs of written archival records will Omeka accept or deal with?
So I think that what matters is how big storage of Omeka you have. So did you just get the free one, which is very limited and how much it can hold, or did you purchase a larger one, or do you have your own server? So if you had, you can get Omeka for free and download it if you have a server. So you'd have to purchase a server, right? So if you have a whole server space, that means you have lots of space for PDFs. So each file has to be under 2 megabytes. So you have to, you have to upload them as individual files. I think that there is a new plugin that is an Omeka PDF reader where you can flip through it. I have not tried that yet. So I'm sure there's a limit on the file size for that too.
Yeah. The other thing you want to think about in terms of importing CVS is to do it in sections. Mm-hmm. So my site has 700 assets on it. So talk about scope creep, right? And I had to do those CVS imports at 100 at a time, because when I tried to do anything bigger than that, I ended up with errors. Things kept getting duplicate. I mean, all kinds of things were happening. So I ended up creating 5 worksheets of 100 each or 200 each, or at least figuring out what. And so 100 was a good practice to do of an import. So that's the other thing you want to think about, is if you end up making larger sites or having more resources on a site.
Also, if you're using the Omeka for your own research, you obviously want this to last. So I would recommend to pay to have it. But if you use it for your classes, I mean, the trial one, it worked well for my class. Because afterwards, I mean, it went away, but it's just like a paper that at the end of the semester you destroy anyway, you know? So it was to serve the purpose. And when we saw some of the exhibits, like Lorena said, that we wanted to give the opportunity to the students to publish through our Omeka site, we talked to them. We asked for permissions and we talked to them and we told them this potentially could be published in our website with your name. So in those instances, they created the Omeka exhibit and collection in our server. But if not, the rest of the students just created their Omeka exhibits and collections and the temporary one just to, get the grade.
We're at 425, just so.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? No?
Well, I hope, I know we've lost quite a few people, but those of you left, can you please join me in thanking our wonderful workshop leaders today?
Thank you. This has
been great. The virtual applause is deafening. Yeah. Thank you, Mark, for turning on your camera for that. Thanks, everyone. No, this has been great. And let's do this again. Yeah,
absolutely. We invite you to visit our site. We will share the recording with you all so that you can share it with your constituents. Feel free to reach out to us if you have any other questions, and put in place those best practices. The librarians are your best friend.
Yay. Right? Well, inspired to do timeline. Yay!
Well, thank you. And just to everyone here who's teaching this semester or getting ready to, good luck. We'll all do our best to support each other and make it through.
Lighting candles for everybody. Yeah.
Yeah.
Masking up. That's right. Yeah. Here we go.
Thank you so much.
Eric, right. Thank you.
This was fun.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
See you guys. Take care.
Bye.
Yeah.